name is Frank Hedgecon. I'm from the Siegel Theater Center. It is our great honor that we have day three of our Penguin Voices International Playwrights Festival. We hear voices from around the world. There are voices that came from Australia, the Ukraine, Turkey, Brazil, Guinea, Germany, and now from Syria. And just before this, now we are going to the next reading, which again will be directed by Rebecca Magor, who also helped to translate it. It's by Bashar Mukus from Palestine. Bashar, where are you? Is he? He is over here. So he flew in from Belgium last night. He was still in Brussels and came here. It was in the theater. There's Rebecca, and who directed also the previous reading. The Penguin Voices Festival is most probably the most significant festival for 1 week. Over 80 writers, playwrights, poets, journalists, novelists from all around the world are here in New York City. Was created under the first years of the Bush government, a reaction by Salman Rushdie, Paul Auster, Michael Roberts, and others to open up the tunnel vision of the American view. They felt we do not hear enough voices. Everybody listens, especially musicians, to music, world music, global music, and every musician would never survive without listening what is going on in their field. But in theater, somehow in America, it is sometimes very isolated. And it is a big island, even though it's a big one, it's still an island, and this is our contribution to really open up and listen to their stories that are of real significance. Penn is also where human rights and writing intersect. It's a great program defending the writers out of all over the world, helping writers who are in prison get them out, and also supporting their work in translation. And they have very, very prestigious literary awards that are giving out by them. So right now we will hear a play, Parallel Time, from Bashar Mukus from Palestine, translated by Rebecca Magor, also directed by her. Thank you so much. If you have your cell phone, this is Malasa, please do take it out. It really never rings in our readings, and I'll do the same. Please do take a moment to make sure it's off. It's all off. Yes.
Salted.
Salted with his own fat tears. Look at him, hypnotized by her eyes.
Wadia walks a lap around the yard. He returns to his previous position. He stares at the gate.
Well, what's up? Is she coming to visit today?
No visiting hours today?
Is she coming today? No visiting hours today.
So then tell this twit to shut up.
Shut up.
I love you, Pop.
It's not clear how anyone benefits from this love story of yours.
I'd do anything for you. You're like a father to me.
Like a father?
Oh, well, more like a little brother. You know, what's most important is ask and you shall receive.
You're turning to the dishes.
Oh, I swore on my left ball I would never clean up after you again.
I cleaned up yesterday.
That rice and pomegranate shit is stuck to that plate like glue. It'll take me a month just to scrape off the rice.
You have something else going on?
Will you guys come in or should I go solo?
We're right behind you.
Wadias stays rooted in place. Fuad takes another lap around and returns to Wadias' side.
Are you waiting for
the mail came yesterday. It already came. Hand delivered. It during morning wreck. No surprises for you.
He was fast asleep during wreck, as usual.
I'm not waiting for the mail.
Are you waiting for someone?
Wadia stands without moving. Fuad and Saleh continue walking laps counterclockwise.
Scene two. The same day, outside Fida's house. Fida is leaving to go to work. She exits her house. She walks in a circle, clockwise, to reach the mailbox. She checks if there is a letter for her. She does not find one. She exits.
Scene three, the same day, the prison yard. The scene picks up where it left off. Wadia stands in place, staring at the gate. Fuad and Saleh walk laps counterclockwise around the yard.
Brother, where's my lighter?
Here.
I want to light up with my lighter.
Saleh searches for his lighter. Wadia stands staring at the gate.
You guys are so boring today.
Come on, brother, check and see if you've got it.
I've got my lighter. Ask Poppy.
You got my lighter?
No.
Who took my lighter?
Well, Poppy, give him his lighter.
Fuad, man, if you got the lighter on you, give it back.
And if I don't?
I will fuck you up.
I swear to God, I ain't got it.
I believe
it. He stands staring at the gate like a statue.
Get a load of the new statue they installed in the yard. It's what they call beautification. This particular statue is in the form of a man, a staring man. Too bad the artist sneezed when he sculpted the nose.
What time is it?
He's ignoring me.
What time is it by you?
You have a watch?
Yeah, I checked my watch. I want to know what your watch says.
I don't have a watch.
Wreck's almost over.
Two more rounds?
I'm going to check if my light is inside.
So my watch is on time.
My watch stopped long ago.
Take off the watch. It's your mind.
I'm going in.
The gate opens. The guard enters. Murad walks behind the guard. He carries a few items with him. A bag, a pillow, a sheet, etc. The guard stops. He watches Murad enter into the yard and then exit. He locks the door behind him. He stays to observe a few minutes, then leaves. Wadia takes a few items from Murad. Fuad takes those things from Wadia. Saleh takes the rest of the things from Murad.
Welcome.
Wadia offers to shake Murad's hand. Murad does not shake it.
What's your name?
I'm Saleh.
Fuad.
Murad shakes Wadia's hand.
I'm Wadia.
My name is Murad.
He's been waiting for you all morning.
The men walk towards an exit.
Scene four. Outside Fida's house, Fida returns from work. She crosses to the mailbox. She checks if a letter has arrived. There is no letter. She goes inside.
Scene five, the same night, in the prison cell. It is small, cramped, and dingy. There is a desk and two bunk beds, a sink, and a hot plate for cooking. Off stage, there is a tiny bathroom, referred to but not seen with a toilet and shower. Fuad and Saleh are asleep in their beds. Murad sits on his bed. Wadie carries a pot of tea. He crosses to Murad and sits next to him. Silence.
Tired.
I know.
I need to sleep.
I added one teaspoon of sugar. Good night.
Wadie crosses to his bed. Murad remains sitting. Wadie takes off his shoes, sits, puts his feet up on the table next to his bed. He leafs through some papers. He studies for an upcoming exam. He has earned his BA in prison. He is now working on his master's. Murad sips his tea. Wadie rips a piece of paper. Murad sips his tea. Wadie studies a piece of paper.
Could I have some more sugar?
That was the last of it.
Sorry.
About what?
I'm afraid to talk.
Why? Voice, man. Okay, you wake up the guys and there'll be no end to it then.
You know what I mean.
There's nothing to be afraid of here. This is it, man. Final destination.
I don't want to be here.
Nobody wants to be here.
Thank you.
For the tea?
No.
Why did they arrest you?
Because I had big dreams.
Here, there's a new kind of tire out there in the market.
Tire?
Yeah, tire, like, you know, the car tires.
Yeah, so?
I'm asking you.
Why?
Let's say my car gets a flat tire one day, right?
What car?
The one I'm gonna buy when I get out of here.
They got these new tires with no extra layer on the inside.
No inside?
It's called a two-ply. Look, I'm no expert on cars, but as I understand it, the tire fixes itself.
So no more flats?
Nah, there's still flats.
What's your line of work?
Not flat tires.
Obviously it's not flat tires.
Why obviously?
Your hands.
What about my hands?
You don't do construction work either.
I play.
What do you play?
Food.
You have no idea how desperate I am to hear some impressive little happy music on the oud. Can you teach me how to play the oud?
How can you learn to play the oud with no oud? There's nothing left of my oud except the strings, and they confiscated those too.
They confiscated the strings here? In the prison property room?
I had them on me when they arrested me. That and my phone and my watch.
Silence. After a moment, Wadie rises with sudden energy and walks quickly to the bunk beds.
Fuad, get up! Get up! Saleh, get up!
What?
Get up!
Count?
No.
Well, now, I don't understand. Who is imprisoning me? The state of Israel or you?
I'm calling it an urgent meeting, okay?
What happened?
Just calm down.
Another intifada broke out?
Calm down and I'll tell you.
Brother, you got to control these bizarre impulses.
I'm not coming down.
Saleh!
I'm coming. I was having a dream. I was dreaming.
Saleh crosses to Wadie. Fuad comes down from his bed and joins the group.
Can somebody explain what's happening?
They all gather around Wadie, who officially starts the meeting.
Good morning.
Scene 6. Several days later, in the street next to Fidat's house. Fidat circles clockwise towards the house. She crosses to the mailbox. She opens it. She finds a letter. She enters the house. Fidat's house. Fidat reads the letter from Wadir. My love, my soul, how are you? Today I feel the clouds lifting, mostly because I'm looking forward to our upcoming visit. 1 hour to renew my heart with love, with your boundless big love. Your love, Fidat, gives me strength and resolve and determination. I was overjoyed to hear you talk about children, about our child, and how we'll raise him together, and how you want him to be like his father, but how I want him to be like his mother. These moments are so unbearably beautiful. A love that brings a child into the world is great indeed. A child, or even many children. Maybe you'll think I'm crazy. I've been thinking in the past few days. I've been losing sleep, planning, thinking about how I ought to act and what I ought to do when you're giving birth in the hospital. And after that, I've been planning every detail of how I ought to act, what I ought to do to be the best father and husband and lover for you. I cried to myself when I held the child. And I stood beside your bed and I kissed you on the forehead. Believe me, we were happy and beautiful in my vision.
Scene 8. The scene picks up a few moments after the previous scene in the prison cell. Wadia has just called a meeting. It is early morning before dawn. Saleh looks for his lighter. Fuad sings a sarcastic homage to Wadia's oud project.
Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la.
Quit messing around, man.
I'm not messing around.
For God's sake, where did my lighter disappear to?
Wadia, I appreciate what you're trying to do for me, but
I'm not doing anything for you.
Just listen to me.
I'm listening. Fuad!
It's impossible. It's very complicated.
Just give it a shot.
No need.
What's the problem, man?
The oud is a very complicated instrument, and we have nothing here.
Shh. Who said we have nothing? We got plenty squirreled away in the hole.
What is with you guys? You think this is summer camp or something?
I think it's ridiculous.
I'm not going into the box again for some oud we end up playing for 2 nights. Last time was enough for me.
Last time we were acting stupid.
Guys, keep your voices down.
Let's say we agree to do it. How are we going to make an oud?
Where there's a will, there's a way.
Man, just forget about this big dream of yours. Seriously, I'm fine without the oud.
Why?
We're better off. I don't need to invite any new disasters into my life.
Hey, man. Think on it. After some fine wood, take a good look at this man sitting next to you. I'm a first-rate carpenter. My woodwork melts.
Lord, every time it's a fucking new drama and all for nothing. Enough already. I want to finish out my last few years in peace. I don't ask for much. I just want to eat and smoke and sleep and piss and masturbate. Count me out. As it is, the universe is one confusing shithole.
You want to stop dreaming?
I'm sick and tired. Of dreaming.
That is precisely what administration wants to hear, man.
I've had enough of you and your bullshit.
Shh. They can hear you on the other side of the world.
I messed things up.
You didn't mess things up. Things mess themselves up.
Let's forget about the oud.
It's not just the oud. Every day he got a new motherfucking plan.
All right, man. That's enough.
No, I want to talk.
Then show some respect.
Fine. Look, Pop. I've got all the respect in the world. go ahead and make your own personal plans, but don't involve us in this shit that is over our heads.
What personal plans?
Ugh, you get me.
No, I don't get you.
I need to get some sleep.
It's almost time for count. Wait a few minutes.
You mean the wedding?
What wedding?
Diaz, Saleh, and Fuad cross quickly to their beds, lie down, and pretend to sleep. Murad watches them and then crosses to the last bed, lies down, and pretends to sleep. Scene 9. The next day. Two simultaneous locations, the prison cell and inside Fida's house. The men in the prison cell prepare for count.
Fida gets ready to travel to the prison. She wears a black shirt and pants. She applies makeup and puts her hair up.
Count!
The guard enters the cell. He counts those present in the room. Each prisoner rises and stands next to his bed as the guard yells out his number.
One. Two. Three. Four. Four. You make your new guest feel welcome. Take good care of him. Come with me. Yeah.
Where to?
You have a visitor.
At the mention of visitors, Saleh goes back to bed.
What about me?
No. And nobody for Murad.
Wadia quickly changes his shirt and then exits with the guard towards the visitor's room. Scene 10. A moment later, on the way to the visitor's room, after a long silence, the guard stops walking.
How are you, Wadia?
I'm fine.
Well, looks like that journalist has taken a special interest in your case. She was here bright and early. Fida. She looks really sad today.
Does her interest in me disturb people in administration?
No, quite the opposite.
They arrive at the door to the visitor's room.
Please, after you.
Scene 11. A moment later in the visitor's room. Fida stands on the other side of the glass. Wadia enters. The guard observes them from the corridor.
Hello.
Hello.
I have good news.
Wait a minute.
Something wrong?
Why are you dressed like that?
What do you mean?
All in black.
What's wrong with it?
And then your hair.
What's wrong with my hair?
You look like you're on your way to a funeral.
Why are you talking with me like this?
I'm just telling you like it is. This is a prison. This is not a cemetery. Just take your hair down.
It will be messy.
Please. Do this with your hands. Just run your fingers through your hair. Slowly, slowly. So good.
How can you smell through the glass?
I can't, but I can imagine. My mother couldn't come?
She's a little tired.
What do you mean tired?
You know, she just got off the plane yesterday. She needs to rest.
From the trip.
From the trip, from lack of sleep, from the flight.
What about you? How's work?
Fine. I'm going straight to work from here. I have a long day ahead.
Fida, you're so sweet.
Wadia, I need to tell you
about... So sweet. last letter, or was it delayed as usual?
I got it.
Why didn't you write back?
I didn't know what to write. Are you okay?
What's the good news?
The scene cuts to the end of their conversation. Fidah has already said goodbye. She stands and then exits. The guard accompanies Wadia out.
Scene 12. Several days later, outside Fidat's house, Fidat returns from work. She crosses to the mailbox. She checks if there is a letter. There is no letter. She goes into the house.
Scene 13. A small yard in the prison. We have not seen this space before. Wadie, Saleh, Fuad, and Murad stand in this small yard, their hands and legs cuffed. A long silence. Wadia smokes a cigarette.
Can someone tell me what's going on?
They're going to take us on a little trip, but not the kind of fancy airplane trips that you're used to.
What's wrong with you?
I mean, we ain't flying off to Paris.
Man, quit messing with me. I need to understand what's happening here.
What is there to understand?
Everything is a joke to you.
They're moving us to another prison, all right?
How long will it take?
Oh, you know, a week, 2 weeks, a month.
They hear a voice from behind the door.
Sir, hey. Sir, can you give me a cigarette?
Why are you calling me sir?
Because you're my father's age.
Do I look old to you, man?
Sir, you're gonna give me a cigarette or not?
How old are you anyway?
14.
You're too young to smoke.
I'll be 15 soon.
There you go.
Lord, what does he need that poison for? It's his age.
What about a lighter?
Wadia searches in his pocket for a lighter.
Give him a lighter.
I do not have a lighter!
Why not give him a lighter?
Thank you, kindly.
Rami smokes and blows the smoke away from the group.
I don't think this plan to build an oud makes sense. We should cut our losses.
Whatever you say.
Sorry, man. But I don't want any problems.
I need to tell you the good news, then.
There's good news?
Yeah.
Why haven't you told us yet?
You think you deserve me telling you any good news?
Come on, Poppy. I can't stand it when you're mad at me.
Which means you're sorry?
Yeah.
Okay, then, I forgive you.
Oh, I love you, Poppy.
What's the good news?
So, Fidah and the lawyer submitted a petition and they're going to start the legal process.
So it's possible there'll be a wedding?
It's certain.
Here in the prison?
Yeah, we'll invite administration. We'll have it in the main office.
Will there be dancing at the wedding?
No, no dancing.
Well, why not?
Because we don't have any music.
Guard enters and opens the door for Rami.
You're too young to smoke. It's not healthy.
Prison, on the other hand, is really healthy for
you. The guard moves the group forward into the prison van. 14. 2 months later, the visitor's room. The guard sits on the other side of the glass in the same place where Fidah sat in the previous scene. Wadia enters and sits.
Well, welcome back. 2 months pass quickly, huh? So I understand from your lawyer that the situation was very hard, very bad over there. How did your lawyer know about the situation over there? I mean, no letters or visitors were allowed. How did she know?
Man, why'd you ask to see me?
I wanted to talk with you.
Why here?
Don't you want to know what this is about?
Really doesn't matter what this is about.
I asked to meet you in the visitor's room because I want my work here. I understand from your lawyer that she submitted all the paperwork for your petition and that you have a court date in 3 weeks.
Which court date?
Come on. The court date
Man, what is your interest in the subject?
I'm the one asking the questions today. Do you understand how this will affect Fidaz's life? Not talking today. You understand that she's not just marrying you. She's marrying a whole cause. You're strapping her down with your sentence, and you've only served a third of it. You got another 20 years. Do you know the meaning of 20 years? But you're asking her to wait 20 years for you on the outside. Why? It's egotism, not love.
It's Fidaz's right to make her own choice. As for you and administration, address you in court.
Oh. Wadia gets up and crosses to the door. He waits for the gate to open.
How old is she today? 29? 30? And how old will she be in 20 years? 50?
The gate opens. Wadia exits. The guard sits in silence for a few moments. Scene 15. Several minutes later. The prison yard. Saleh, Fuad, Murad and Rami are out clockwise. Wadia enters.
Well, how was it?
Don't you want to develop the film?
What's that mean, develop the film?
I'll explain later.
There was no visit.
What was there?
I'm gonna go get some exercise.
What's with the sudden desire for exercise? If you wanted exercise so badly, why didn't you come out to rep this morning?
That's enough. Leave him alone.
Wadia starts to run around the yard.
He doesn't want to tell us what happened.
He'll tell us later.
Wadia sprints around the yard as the rest walk. Fuad stops walking. Murad notices Fuad and goes up to him.
What does it mean to develop the film?
It means you take a nap after the visit.
Why?
So you can go to sleep and continue the visit in your dream.
They continue walking. Scene 16. A continuation of the previous scene, in the prison yard. The guard enters and watches the men from afar. They do not notice him. Wadia...
with you today.
They already handed out the mail today.
They handed it out.
Nothing came?
No, nothing.
Today we hold a conference.
You're not gonna tell us what happened?
We need this conference as soon as possible.
Why, dear?
Everything is fine.
What are we gonna talk about in the meeting? But Wood, of course.
Wadia! Come here, I wanna talk with you.
The other men start walking again as Wadia and the guard cross to the side.
You smoke?
Man, how many years you've known me?
Two men.
Then why are you asking?
An excuse to offer you a cigarette. Do you want a cigarette with
you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
The guard takes out a packet of cigarette and offers Wadia one. Wadia takes out his own packet of cigarettes. The guard offers him a lighter. Wadia lights up with his own lighter.
Yes, you wanted to talk to me about something, or can I just go back to rec?
You have something to tell me?
No, I don't.
You sure about that?
I'm sure.
They smoke.
How's your mother doing? She hasn't come for a visit in a long time.
She's fine, thank God.
Well, why hasn't she been coming to visit then?
Because she's tired from the trip.
Oh, okay. I see.
You see?
Yeah. I was worried that she...
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I was worried she wasn't happy with you. Or she wasn't happy with this idea of you getting married. Well, God forbid, she doesn't like Fidaz.
Man, this cigarette.
Do you really think this marriage petition will succeed?
What do you think?
Right.
Yeah,
the cigarette is done.
Scene 17.
Scene 18. Several days later, Fidat returns from work and checks the mailbox. She finds a letter. She goes into the house. She reads the letter. My dearest Fida, I miss you and everybody. For the next visit, I'm asking that my mother come with you. I'm starting to worry about her continued absence. My love, I'm writing to you about something that you'll need to consider deeply. I don't want romantic notions to keep me from thinking logically. I believe a couple should bring children into the world after getting married in order to embody their union through the fruit of their love. Because of this belief, I would like to ask you to preserve your fertility by freezing your eggs, especially after what I've read and looked into.
Fida stops reading. She stands holding the letter. Scene 19, several weeks later, the prison cell. Wadie, Saleh, Fouad, and Murad are gathered round the table. They stare down at the strings of the oud. Rami stands guard near the door. He peers out the small hole to make sure nobody's coming down the corridor. It is winter. The cell is cold and damp. The men are not feeling well. They cough and sneeze and blow their noses. There's a stomach virus spreading through the prison. The men take turns guarding and running to the bathroom.
How did you manage to pull it?
Impossible. The stealing of the strings. My job in the prison is distributing food down the corridors. I have experience, my brother. First lesson, know which officer you're dealing with. Is he a stupid conscript or a bastard sergeant? Whoever he is, is a human being. He has particular characteristics. You've got to know which ones are vigilant, which ones can read body language. So we planned our visit to the property room during the shift of the naive private. Pulling this shit off is a delicate art.
Can somebody replace me?
Okay. You just started. What's the deal?
I need to go to the bathroom.
Go. I'll take over for now.
Rami turns to go to the bathroom. Saleh grabs Rami's arm and speaks privately to him.
Rami. Yeah? Take a look. Under the toilet. See if my lighter fell under the toilet.
Rami runs to the bathroom. Saleh takes his place guarding the door.
I'm after Rami in the bathroom.
It's all quiet now. I suggest we start assembly before the next guard rotation.
Shouldn't we wait for Rami?
Oh, Rami.
We can't wait.
Yeah, we can, but we need to start this meeting soon.
Okay. So take your time, Rami.
Come on, Rami!
Does anyone have a visit tomorrow?
Well, my mother's supposed to come.
My mother and Fida are coming tomorrow.
Rami comes out of the bathroom.
Why didn't you flush?
There's no water.
Did you find the lighter?
I will have a heart attack.
There will be water in the morning.
So we can shower before the visits?
Didn't you say you had to take a shit?
I'm going. I don't know if anyone's coming to visit me tomorrow.
Of course. Somebody is going to come from your family.
Comrade Wadia, I... Why are you laughing?
Yes, Comrade Rami.
Could you help me write a letter tomorrow?
Excuse me. Excuse me. Oh, lovely. Tell the guard I need a new stand.
We don't have extra.
No. I could help you write a letter too, if you want. I have an idea about the belly of the oud.
Wait for Murad to get back.
I looked all over the prison and I couldn't find anything that would work for that part of the oud. The ribs on the belly, you know, it's curved like that. It's fucking complicated.
Right. If we don't do this together and have a formal conference, we're never going to find a solution. Wait. Murat will return and we'll start the conference then.
Who do you want to write a letter to?
Nobody. It's not important.
Wadiya crosses to the bathroom.
Hey, Murat, how long are you going to take in there, man?
Murat comes out of the bathroom.
I understand from Murat that the belly shape. So I thought I'd make something square.
But square!
And I'll tell you why in a minute. What's important is that it's hollow inside, right? Murat?
Right.
So, why square?
Easier to build.
Smart kid. The curved ribs require a special wood, and that's difficult. Can't get it. But I've been thinking a lot about how to make the belly of the oud square from the materials we have available.
And did you find a solution?
I have an idea.
Okay, what is it?
But I'm not so sure.
Well, just try it.
The backgammon boards, one on top of another.
That wood is thin and cheap, it's not good.
Not all boards are made of the same cheap wood.
If the wood's too thin, it won't work. All of this effort will be useless.
Quad pulls a backgammon board out from under the bed.
And the wood is dry and cracked.
So what's the solution?
There is no solution.
That's the backgammon board from the commissary. But the boards that the Red Cross brings us, like the one I used to have, they're made of strong wood. Good wood.
Oh, sure. So tomorrow I'll just collect all the boards from all the cells.
We don't want the whole prison to know about the oud. It'll go straight to administration.
You're right about that.
So what do we do?
Let me just figure it out.
How?
Trust me.
Quad gets up suddenly and runs to the bathroom.
Where to?
To the movies.
Quad goes into the bathroom and shuts the door. Scene 20. The next morning. The prison cell. The men get ready. We hear the sound of the shower. Murat, Rami, and Saleh sit round the table. Wadiya is sleeping.
Hey man, what's the deal?
Give him some space.
I'm going to be late for my visit.
You're not going to be late. You'll take your shower, you'll put your cologne on. There's time.
A smooth shave takes time, brother.
Will they tell me if someone comes for me?
The guard will come and call each of us by name.
He'll call you too?
If someone comes to visit me.
What? Come on!
Okay, almost done.
Silence. After a moment, Fuad comes out. Murat goes in and closes the door.
Sorry, man, there's no more hot water.
There was hot water? No.
The sound of the shower in the bathroom. Fuad dresses and gets ready in front of the mirror. He puts on cologne.
Poppy. Come on, Poppy. Get up. Poppy. Comrade Wadiya, rise and shine. Arise and get up. Your coffee awaits. Poppy. You want me to bring you breakfast in bed, sweetheart? Come on, comrade. Get up. You want the guards to drag you out of bed and take you straight to your visit?
Enough with the cologne, man. You're suffocating us.
Well, maybe it'll get rid of this swampy, damp mildew smell.
Man, no cologne can keep with that smell.
Your mother won't smell the cologne anyway.
Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do.
Happy. How old are you?
20.
20?
Yeah, 5 months I'll be 20.
So your birthday is in 5 months?
Hopefully.
He's lying, don't believe him.
I know. My birthday's in 2.5 months.
How old will you be?
15.
Do, re, mi, fa, sol.
mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do.
Ugh. Hurry up, Murad. Poppy is after you.
I took a shower last night.
Okay, so get up and get dressed.
Wadia gets up slowly, lazily. The sound of the shower stops.
You want some cologne?
Why are you such an idiot?
Murad flicks cologne on Wadia.
Cut it out, man. Cut it out.
And runs away. Murad comes out of the bathroom with flecks of shaving cream on his face.
Stop. You need some perfume,
don't,
sweetheart.
Don't touch me with that perfume, man.
It's not up to you.
Wadia stops. He lets Juan dab cologne on him. Wadia goes into the bathroom.
Put a little on me.
Nice shave.
You too.
Give me your hand.
Juan sprinkles cologne on Murad's hand. Wadia comes out of the bathroom, drying his face with a towel. We hear the guard walking down the corridor towards the cell.
Should I shave my beard, or do you think it's okay?
Oh, swell.
And how is my beard?
Yours is the best beard in all of Palestine.
The guard opens the door.
Count! One, two, three, four. Five. Good morning. Visiting hours. Fuad, you have a visitor, your mother.
Who?
Your mother. Wadia, you have a visitor, not your mother.
Wadia exits. The guard exits. Rami stands in silence. Saleh sits on his bed. Scene 21. Half an hour later, the prison cell. Saleh and Rami are alone in the room. Rami stands guard by the door. Saleh holds a backgammon board, turning it over in his hands, trying to figure out how to build the belly of the oud.
Is there a chance the oud will work?
It will work.
What are we still missing?
A few screws, a screwdriver, a mouse, glue, a saw, pegs for the wound, wood for the neck. We're missing a lot.
What's a mouse?
It's a sanding machine. A mouse detail sander. Smooths the wood.
Oh, where are we going to find all these things?
We'll build them.
How?
Of course, even better.
How many years have you been inside?
10.
Don't you get bored?
If I get bored, I die.
I'm also not bored.
Why didn't you answer me when I asked you about the letter?
When?
Yesterday.
You remember?
You forgot?
No.
Me neither.
I was embarrassed. Why did they arrest you?
A soldier was kidnapped.
Where is he now?
The orders were that if anything got caught, then it would be necessary to get rid of him.
Instructions from whom?
From above.
From above. Like God, you mean?
And you? What got you arrested?
I was at a protest. I was burning a flag, and I tried to escape, but I fell down and they got me.
Where was the protest?
Jerusalem.
You came all the way down from the Golan Heights to protest in Jerusalem?
No, I work in
You've
Jerusalem.
Got your own issues up there.
I work there.
So, you've been out of school for how long?
Saleh takes out a carefully stashed folder of stationery and a pencil case. Saleh sits down next to the desk.
What
What do you want to write?
Sala spreads a selection of different colored pens and pencils on the table. Rami chooses a color.
Dear Mom, it's me, Rami. How are you? And how are you doing? I'm okay. I'm feeling fine. The comrades here are looking out for me real good. There's no reason for you to come here, Mama. The trip is hard. I'm fine. And dandy. I am in the same prison that you were in. And I know how hard the trip is to get here. I remember when we used to come visit you. It was so cold in the village when we left in the morning. Sometimes there was even snow. And that made our trip more difficult. And most of the time they didn't even let us, most of the time they didn't let us visit you. I'll be home in 5 months. The situation here is better than you told me. The prison is very clean. The beds are comfortable. And we sit around laughing all the time. They had showers and toilets to the room since you were here. Mama, my beard is coming in. I'm going to buy a razor and shaving cream from commissary today. I have the money. How are you all? How are my brothers? How's Papa? Let me know that you're all okay. Mama, don't.
Scene 22. 2 weeks later, in the visitor's room, Odia sits at a table. Vida enters. The guard observes from the corridor.
What are you hiding from me?
How about you say hello first?
I don't want to waste time on the obvious.
Saying hello is obvious?
Vida, just answer me.
What?
Why are you treating me like this, like a child? And why did my mother come today? If something's happened, tell me, okay? Because when my father died, I didn't even have a chance to see him or hear his voice. And at least I want to hear from her. I want to hear her voice. How old is she now?
Your mother is fine. What day is she? She's getting old. Time is racing by. She'll probably come for the next visit.
Yeah, for God's sake, Vida, please, okay? I'm begging you, even if my whole family is hiding something from me, if there is anything, you have to tell me.
Okay.
You promise?
I promise.
I forgot to ask you about the petition.
I bought you a suit for the wedding. I deposited it in the property room.
Serious?
Everyone's surprised. The lawyer was amazing. She gave 110%, and the case got a lot of attention in the media. It's becoming a matter of public interest. After all that pressure, they agree.
All these things are happening, and I did nothing to help.
And there's a date set?
When?
5 months?
That soon? How's it going for your parents?
They still don't entirely understand it. And all the attention from the media and the reporters, it stresses them out more. But very slowly, they're warming to the idea. You know, every time we talk, I think I finally explain things to them, but then they always have more questions. They're worried about me. Don't you want to know how I'm doing?
How are you doing?
I went to buy you a suit.
Are you sure about this?
Yeah.
I'm also prepping a surprise for you.
What?
I can't tell you here.
So why bring it up?
Because I'm going to find a way to tell you.
When?
As soon as possible.
Wadia gets up and exits quickly. Fidas sits for a few moments, then exits. Scene 23. Immediately following the previous scene, after exiting the visitor's room, Wadia crosses quickly through the yard towards the cell. He passes right by Saleh, Fuad, Murad, and Rami, but ignores them in the haste to reach his cell. Scene 24. A moment after, two simultaneous locations, inside the bathroom of the prison cell and outside on the street near the prison. Wadia street, Fidas' cell phone rings. It is an unknown number.
Hello? Hello?
Fida.
Hello?
It's me, Fida.
Wadia?
Yeah, you're talking with me in Hebrew now, you know anything.
I thought it was a call related to work.
Oh, you're mistaken. It's a call related to love.
how are you calling me?
Listen to me quickly, okay?
Talk.
I've also been making plans for a wedding, me and the guys. And you told me we want to sing and dance at our wedding, right? I mean, we're making an oud.
An oud?
Yes. A local oud, handcrafted in cell number 4, right here. And it's all handmade, homegrown. The guys are building everything from scratch. It's a square oud, but that's not important. What's important is the sound. It's an oud made out of backgammon boards. Can you believe it? They cleaned them, they glued them, and then they did everything. Before you know it, we're going to open our own music school here in this prison. Everything's going to be made right here, my love. And the saw is from a big can of tuna. Saleh made it. The strings came from from outside with a musician. He's the one who's going to play the oud at our wedding. And I asked him if he can teach me how to play the oud after we make it. The pegs of the oud are made from the tips of wood spoons, you know, that we use for our soup. You know the ones I mean, right? And we're doing all this in secret. One guy guards, one guy works. Sometimes I help, but I'm not very useful, and every time I hold the sander, I end up injuring my finger. So Saleh said it's better. I only end up messing things up.
The guard enters, without Wadia noticing.
The subject I'm studying right now is very detailed. And after I finish it, I'll send it to you in a letter, and if you think the essay is good, you can publish it in the newspaper. Look, and nobody can know about the oud. If the administration finds out about the news, and they might find out, the whole thing is going to be ruined. And you understand this, Fidai. Fida, are you there? Hello?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. Look, I'm sorry, I'm coming on and on.
When will you finish the oud?
But I'm hoping that we'll be finished before the wedding because...
Wadia stops talking mid-sentence. He senses
Wadia?
Someone outside the bathroom. He quickly hides the phone.
Wadia? Wadia?
Wadia exits and sees the guard.
Whoa, how come you're not in the yard?
Diarrhea, man.
Oh, diarrhea.
Yeah, all the guys have diarrhea.
You and I, we got some more talking to do.
About what?
I'd like to invite you for a cup of tea in my office. You accept?
Saleh, Fuad, Murad, and Rami return from recreation. The guard exits. Scene 25. Several months later, the prison cell. Night. Wadia, Saleh, Fuad, and Murad stand around the table. Rami is in the bathroom. Suddenly, the lights cut out. Complete darkness.
What happened?
Bring it here.
Put it on the table.
I can't see nothing.
Keep your voice down, man.
Oh, shit, I think I'm gonna drop it.
Give it to me, I'll hold it.
What happened to the light?
Okay.
Happy birthday.
Come on, let's cut the cake.
Murad takes a candle from the cake so he can go find the knife. He gets the knife and gives it to Rami.
Good luck.
Thank you so much, all of you, for all of this.
Thanks, Saleh.
I really appreciate it.
Thanks, Saleh. He's the one who planned it all.
No, we all planned it together.
Thank you, Saleh.
Saleh takes a lit candle and crosses to his bed.
Where are you going? I need to get back to work. If we keep taking and taking breaks, we won't ever finish the oud. The wedding is around the corner.
Guys, eat cake. Saleh?
Too sweet for me.
They cut the cake and eat. Saleh sits on the ground, the various parts of the oud next to him. In the light of the candle, Saleh sands the piece he plans on using for the pegs. He tries to stand without making any noise. Fuad crosses to his bed and sits down.
Today?
I'll stand guard.
No. I'll stand guard.
No. Cut it out. It's your birthday.
So what? You let me stand guard and you go help Saleh.
Whatever you say.
Let me help a little.
No need. You go study. Your exam is in 2 weeks.
Brother, I studied enough.
Go study some more.
Stop worrying about me. Okay, this exam would be easier than the last one, and I aced the last one, so I'm surely gonna pass the next one.
Man, it's your last exam. Give it all you got.
Fuad, is everything good?
Yeah.
Good, guys. I think someone's coming.
Saleh and Murad hide oud parts. Fuad and Wadia extinguish the candles. Everyone goes to their bed and pretends to sleep. The guard opens the door. He holds a flashlight. He shines it on each bed in turn.
Very happy birthday, Rami. You have the same birthday. It's not nice, you know. I wished you a happy birthday. You didn't respond. I could hear you guys on the other side of the carpet. And now all of a sudden, you're all asleep. Wadia. Your tea is ready.
What tea?
You remember. A while back, I promised to invite you for a cup of tea.
Yeah, I remember.
Come on, let's have our tea.
Right now, in the middle of the night?
That's the best time for tea.
Here's some wine.
Wadia rises and moves towards the door.
Thanks for the birthday wish, Hansel.
The guard exits and closes the door. Darkness. Scene 26. Several hours later, solitary confinement in a different prison. In the darkness, we hear footsteps receding, the sound of an iron door opening, then slamming shut. A dim light rises. Wadia is chained, suspended by his legs, his legs hovering above the ground. He is unconscious. Long silence. Black. Scene 27. Later that same week, in the prison yard, recreation. Fuad and Murad are saying goodbye to Rami. Solace stands off to the side.
You watch yourself.
You too.
We'll see you soon.
Go on. Get out of here. I'm getting out soon too.
Murad embraces him. Rami heads towards the exit. Before he reaches the gate, Sala approaches him.
Watch out for yourself.
Don't worry about me.
I'm not worried. As soon as he's back from his visit.
I really wanted to be with you guys for the wedding.
You go play in the snow. Up there. Where you can see the whole city.
When you get out, I'll invite you to our place. We'll play in the snow together.
Rami turns to exit.
Don't forget, you invited me.
I won't forget.
Rami places something in Saleh's hand.
Take it.
What's this?
My lighter.
A gift?
Yeah. When I get back to the village, I'll buy a new one.
No. You keep it. I'm afraid I'll lose it.
What's the story with your lighter?
It was also a gift.
From whom?
From my father.
So this is a gift for me. Take it.
Sala embraces him. Rami walks clockwise around the yard. Sala, Fuad, and Murad begin walking counterclockwise. Rami moves to the outside of the circle on the periphery of the yard. Rami exits. The others continue to walk round counterclockwise in silence. Scene 28. Minutes later, in the prison yard, Saleh, Fuad, and Murad are out for recreation. Wadia returns from his visit. He attempts to cross the yard to get to his cell. He walks unsteadily and then falls to the ground. The men gather around him, then pick him up and take him to his cell. Scene 29. Later that night, the prison cell. Wadia, Saleh, Fuad, and Murad lie in their beds. They stare out at nothing in particular. They speak to nobody in particular. Wadia.
My head is very crowded lately.
What are you thinking about?
What's the meaning of all this?
All this what?
You know. Situation here. Time, love, friendship, freedom. Inside, outside, the sun. You know what I mean. Fatigue, dreams.
Who told you all of this has meaning?
It has to be a meaning.
Why does there have to be?
Then why were we created?
I need to sleep.
Do you think
I've stopped dreaming?
You mean at night?
At night? During the day?
Have you always had dreams?
Many dreams.
What have you dreamed about?
My last dream, I dreamt I was a little boy at home, and I was sitting with my family. And my father had come back from prison on a family visit. He was roasting chestnuts.
Oh, man. Chestnuts.
My father loved chestnuts. It was raining.
Yesterday, I had a dream. I was on stage, playing the oud. And my strings started to snap one by one. Kept playing because you have to keep playing. The show goes on. I played another string snap.
All the strings snapped?
All of
them. Was the audience upset?
No. Audience was happy.
But you were upset and the oud was destroyed.
I don't know why the audience was happy.
Solace sits up in bed. He turns his lighter over in his hands. He lights a cigarette.
I went into the room. She was sitting behind the glass as usual. I looked at her. She seemed very old. Her hair seemed white. I said hello to her. She said, hello. She looked at me with this smile on her face. I couldn't read it. It was a new smile. I wanted to hug her. Her body was tense and her back was hunched over. I was silent. I don't know what to say. I thought I should ask her how she was doing. I didn't ask her. She was embarrassed. I could see it in her smile. I looked into her eyes. She looked around the room. She looked into my eyes like she was searching for something. I averted my eyes. I looked at the floor, the shoes, dirty, and then after a while I raised my eyes. I had to say something, so I asked her about my sister, Nala. How is Nala? Fine, she's great, she said. And Mahmoud, how is he? How are the kids? And she was silent. They're okay, I asked her. And Abdullah, how is he doing? She kept silent. I don't know what more to ask, so I fell silent too. After a while she said to me, everybody's fine. But how do you know about my children? What do you mean, how do I know about your children? I told her. You know them? She asked. Yeah, I know them. I know them well. Mama? She didn't recognize me. She thought about all of it. I felt the tear welling up, and I blocked it because I didn't want to cry in front of her. And right now, I'm blocking the tears because, to me, the only time I'm going to cry is when I get out. I want to sleep.
Scene 30. 2 months later, a room in the prison which we have not yet seen. After thorough tuning, he begins to play. Fida enters in a white dress. This scene is not the actual wedding. It is a developing of the film, the dream during the nap after the visit. Wadia enters in his suit. Saleh enters with Rami. Fuad and the guard enter. It is the finale. They all walk in a circle. The music ends. They all stand in place.
I'm writing a letter to a child who has not yet been born. I'm writing to an impression, a dream, without form or consciousness. Before he has ever become a reality, he already scares the prison guard. I'm writing to every boy, whoever was, and every girl. I write to my child, who has not yet breathed the air of this world. I write to my child, Elad. A name that means birth. Birth of the future. Birthday celebration, Elad. birth and rebirth. That is how I want the future to know us. Dear Melodic, today I mark my 25th year in prison, 9,131 and a quarter days. It's a number without a name. It's an age of incarceration long from over. And here I am. I've reached the age of 50, and my life is divided into two halves. Each day I spend in prison cancels its full day in life. Like a bag that turns inside out and empties itself of all remaining memory. Prison is like a fire that consumes all fragments of memory. And my memory, how it breaks my heart, has become numb. Incinerate in the fire of prison and forgetfulness. But you are the most beautiful thing I've smuggled out from my memory. You're my message to the future. After these months have sucked dry the milk of their fellow months. These years have canceled out their fellow years. Do you think I'm insane? Writing to an unborn child. It is insanity, isn't it? A state with nuclear weapons wages battle against a child yet to be born and declares this child to be a security threat, intelligence reports, court appeals, or is the threat my dreaming of a child? It is insanity. I write a letter about dreaming, and this dream becomes a file in the state security agency. Yeah. You, my dear, now have a file in the vault of the Israeli. Will I stop dreaming? I'll continue to dream, despite the bitter reality. I will search for meaning in life despite all I have lost in life. I'll dig up the tombs of our fathers in search of imaginary roots as if we seek out a better future for our children. And that it will come. Goodbye, my child Milaj. Peace, my love.
Scene 32. On the stage of the theater, the actors rise and cross towards the audience and stop. They do not walk in a circle. They stand in place. The time of the play ceases.
Places and where life and dreams and realities and possibilities and meet. Tell us a little bit about the play. How did you come to write it?
Actually, I started with the team making a research. We wrote for 1 year.
Can you hear all well?
No.
We have to a bit louder. Yeah. It
So,
okay. So we started from a research. It was a long process research. We spent 1 year researching. First of all, we started talking about political prisoners like in all over the world. Then we go specifically in the Israeli jail. And then we find some stories, and then we focus on them. And then we started to try to contact these people that they are inside jail and their families. And we went to finally to the studio to work. So it was a really long process. We worked almost 1 year and a half to wrote it and to direct it, to show it. It was a crazy journey, actually, to go with this. I understood that also me, I had a lot of stereotypes in my mind about them. And I was really surprising all the time from how they deal with their lives, with the time, with the place, with their dreams. So actually this piece is it's inspired from real stories. For some prisoners, I was focused in a biography of a prisoner called Walid Dabka that he is until today in the jail, and also about the group that were with him.
So you said you did some universal research around the world. How did you? How did that look like? What did you do?
We read a lot of things. But I think the most interesting thing it was when I started to try to connect them. I sent them a letter first of all. Then I got the letter. Then I met his family, his mother, and I have something like 20 hours recording with his family, with his friends. Actually, the turning point it was when I first read the letter, the last one. It's actually a letter that Walid Dabka wrote. I understood that it's a real different reality, and it was very important for me to try to. Work with it a little bit because they are in a real bad situation from the two sides, also from the Israeli side and also from the Palestinian side, because the Palestinian side they want to see them all the time as heroes, and the Israeli side all the time want to see them as a criminal or a number. And for me, I don't see any difference between hero or number. The two of them. Find this basic story that I found it in Walid's life. I see it as a love story. And I think that this is the way that I choose to work in this process.
Next to me is Marvin Carlson, a colleague at the Graduate Center CUNY, and perhaps the foremost theater historian in the world. It's also focusing on plays from the Arab world, from North Africa. But Marvin, when you listen to the play, what comes to your mind?
I guess the thing that strikes me the most about the play is how normal the people are. That is, in of course they're in a terrible situation, or really an intolerable one, and yet they have dreams, they have aspirations. I find the project of Billy Yehud is a wonderful illustration of how, in the most absolutely impossible circumstances, still there is a human spirit that connects all of them. The all has a feeling that from outside that, oh, it must be constant suffering, and the suffering is always there. But still, there are birthday parties. The play, which in a makes the imprisonment of them, the confinement of them, that more bizarre. And because they're just people, they're normal people with normal desires and normal pleasures, normal frustrations. They've lost the lighter or whatever. So I think this is what struck me is the contrast between the impossible, the intolerable, the unimaginable situation there, and the fact that the humanity is always there also. That's what struck me.
Tell us a bit more about in your work as a playwright. Where does that play fit in? How many other plays have you done? Yeah. What are you working on?
Yes, this production was premiered 4 years ago in the Maidan Theater.
In what?
And Maidan Theater, Haifa.
Haifa? Mm-hmm.
4 years. 3 years ago. Yeah. 3 years ago. And after that, I did a lot of projects before it. My last project was also I worked with 30 Palestinian actors from all over, from different places from the world, and we premiered this project 4 months ago in Jerusalem and Haifa. I'm working now in a theater, a new theater, that it's called the Khashabi Theater. It's a new independent theater in Haifa that I established with a group of actors that we've been working together since 6 years. That we started as a group of artists where we are working in different theaters, and then we choose to build our place.
If I understand right, Haifa is kind of a hub in the Palestinian scene also, but also in the Israeli scene. Can you tell us a little bit about the scene? What is happening there?
I just brag a little bit about your theater, though. I think maybe you're not getting the picture of how special the Khashoggi Theater is. So Bashar founded it with four other ensemble members, and they have in this, the ensemble was founded several years earlier, but the theater opened its doors 2 years ago, and since it opened its doors in 2015, it houses the Khashoggi Ensemble, which has a full season of original theater, and then they also have exhibits in the space, they have comedy nights, they have film screenings, they have lectures, and so this space in and of itself has really become a very important place and hub for Palestinian arts and culture for the whole region.
And the Palestinian culture and art, it's, in each year you can feel that it's going to be more and more powerful inside the city. What is interesting, that it's starting to be like talking in a high level, so we start to feel that there is a real dialogue, and that this kind of dialogue that you are talking with someone from downstairs, that you can make your dialogue in a high level, that it's that I found it really interesting in Haifa, and it's one of our aims that to build Khashoggi Theater. But still, for example, this piece, Parallel Time, we produce it in the Maidan Theater, that it's a real old, theater in Haifa, that the theater take his money from the Israeli cultural municipality.
They get funding from the Ministry
of culture. And they cut the funding for this piece. just the, also the municipality of Haifa, they kept the money from the theater because of my work. So because of that, Haifa, it's really weird. Now we are trying to find our independent place to be like, not connected in a way, but really open for with the dialogue.
Tell us a bit about your process of writing. I've seen you say you work with actors, so how do you sit in your room, you write, you type in a computer, or do you then improvise it, or do you collectively create the work? How is your process of the writing?
It's really different from project to another project. For example, in parallel time, I started in the research, then we had first workshop with the material of the research, then I went to wrote the first draft, then we had the second workshop, so it's this kind.
Of independent theaters in Cairo or Amman. Is that kind of travel accessible to you? Do you go or can you go to any of the various Arab theaters?
Yes, we can. We don't make it because when there is an independent festival inviting independent theater, so there is no money to travel. This is the problem. But this we can do it. We can do it. Khashoggi Theatre having a really beautiful, let's say, surprising also, so beautiful demand. Care from a lot of festivals and a lot of theatres. We tried to go to Egypt like the last year, but it was really open. It's really hard to go without a festival that can invite you.
So Rebecca, did you see the play? So you translated it. What were the challenges in translating?
I did see the play. I saw it in 2014.
In Haifa.
In Haifa? Yes.
Tell us a bit, how was that? What about the scene? And
it was a very special, the play was running in Arabic, and then this, and the mainstream Jewish population in the country wasn't paying attention to the play because it was in Arabic, so it's really, for the most part, it's not accessible to most of the population there. And then I actually saw the first show that you performed with Hebrew subtitles. Yeah, and I think that's when the trouble began. The people who closed down the theater and were protesting against this play never actually read the play. I remember when I saw this play, first of all, I thought several things. That Bashar, in addition to being a very wonderful writer, is also a great director. And so I think when you see the kind of ensemble work that the Khashoggi Theater does, it was a great experience, and we had amazing actors for this reading. But I think what you have to understand is that the way Bashar writes as a playwright is very theatrical. So there's a lot of action going on, and there's a lot of things happening in between and under the text that we can't understand or see in a reading. And so that's one of the things that I really love about his writing. And so in addition to, again, the structure of the play, the interesting and beautiful characters that he developed in this play, the theatricality of the work, these are all things that made me want to translate it. And in addition, I'm also very interested in the politics of the play. think it might be interesting to mention that the last time that I actually went into the Khashoggi Theater in November, there was an exhibit there of George Jackson in The Son of Palestine. And George Jackson, of course, the famous Black Panther and Marxist activist, was imprisoned in the U.S. And so there was this really striking, it wasn't too unspoken or subtle, but there was a solidarity, a expression of solidarity between this activist and the Palestinian activist. And so I was very interested in those connections because, I think, as Frank knows and Marvin knows, that I'm very interested in play, specific situation, and this is a story about these very specific Palestinian characters, but at the same time, this play has things that we need to listen to as Americans. We also deal with issues of long-term incarceration, police brutality, and that this is a play that can provoke us into thinking about the challenges we face in our own society.
I'd like you to say a little bit more along those same lines as to exactly what offended the authorities in this play. That is, was it the general conditions, the solitary confinement, I'm also interested, and this is so often the case, that some of the people who complained about it had not read it or seen it. And so my question is kind of a double one. What were they actually objecting to, and what did they think was in the play that they didn't like that may or may not have even been there?
I don't know to answer what they really think, but I know that me as a director, writer, my wall, or what I'm fighting for, it's my narrative. To set my identity by it.
Right.
And we all know that maybe, let's say, the Israeli system really afraid to hear another narrative. Just to hear it. Because it was really crazy, like play running for more than 1 year. And for me, it's running in the mainstream Palestinian theater. And it's still soft. I have some more works that are.
In that you need to give this play to somebody to get a license to present
no, no, no,
like that. The censorship is sort of after the fact.
Yes.
That is, they then say this is not acceptable.
The problem that it happened also with other shows. For example, there is a choreographer called Rakhal Zayt, and they also stopped his show after. But what is happening now that actually they don't need to stop more shows, It's already built in inside the organization that's taking money from the system. And what is really interesting for me and really powerful for me is to read this text today when also two real characters from the piece and with Khamsmit. Palestinian prisoners, they are in a
hunger strike
since 22 days. I think it's important to read it here also.
So we went a little bit over time, so maybe there's one comment or one more thing for you to add from here. Next week is supposed to start in 10 or 11 minutes with the cast. We still have to set it up, but thank you really for flying in from Belgium to be with us tonight, Rebecca, for being here, Marvin, and Steno so often deals, the plays are in hospitals, we all sick people. We all a little bit crazy, and this is also in a prison, we all prisoners in some way, and the way is how to relate to it in a human way, but also looking at, your structures and systems that
that create this. So really, thank you all for listening. I hope you will be able to stay for a very unusual play from Korea about a North Korean defector who has to go back and forth. Something very unusual also. But again, thank you for coming, and a big applause for you.